Good afternoon. Welcome to Sports Nothing But Sports with Ken Sterling for Thursday, July 11th, 2019. Brought to you by the great people at Today's Dentistry. Give them a call. Become their next new patient. They're terrific at what they do. I've been a patient there the last 26 years. Nobody is more empathetic, friendly, and professional than Dr. Mike O'Neill and his entire staff at Today's Dentistry. 317-849-2933. We're kind of coming out of it today. Stuff to talk about. We've got baseball starting today, one game, and then everybody plays over the weekend. And finally, we got stuff to talk about other than the NBA Summer League, which has not been kind to the Indiana Pacers. But let's face it, it doesn't really matter because we aren't going to remember any part of this. You only really have a couple of guys who are going to be with a big club this coming fall. So let's not worry about the Summer League. The Pacers and Toronto, they play tonight, 6 o'clock, that game on ESPN3, which I think that also means that it's going to be on NBA TV. Wimbledon semifinals a little bit earlier today for the women. Men's semifinals tomorrow. Women's finals on Saturday. Men's finals on Sunday. Wimbledon always kind of cool. The fortnight continues. And then Friday. Friday afternoon, the Cubs are in Pittsburgh for kind of that beginning of the second half, and hopefully the Cubs can get their asses in gear and start to play baseball like it means something. They are driving me nuts the front end of this season. You know what? They're 4 games over .500, which is not good. It's a good thing that the rest of that division is mediocre, because if that wasn't the case, they would have dug themselves a serious hole in that first half. And to talk about the Cubs, that great purveyor of wisdom at CubsInsider.com, Evan Altman.
What in the world do we expect of the Chicago Cubs in the second half?
Oh, boy. Ideally, more than what we saw in the first half, at least, you know, in terms of consistency. And that's, I think it's a difficult part, you know, when you look at a team that's in first place and you could still sit there and say it was disappointing.
Right.
And so then, you know, how do you really reconcile that? Say, well, hey, if they just do the same thing, shouldn't they end up in first? But I think if anyone is looking at that seriously and saying this is a team that was, over their last 51 games, I think 7 games under .500 in that stretch, and that's out of 90 games in the first half. So for the better part, and if you look at the first part, you know, when they're 2-7, so 5 games under, and they're 7 games under, well, then in the middle there, they were, something like 16 games over for the other 30 games or something. So if we get that team that we saw through most of, mid-April to, like, mid-May, great. Cubs will be fine. But if we see the team that we just saw for the last month and a half, that's not going to work out.
The lack of offensive productivity is a problem. Who's to blame?
Everyone.
Do we blame the guys? Do we blame Madden? Do we blame the new hitting coach? I mean, we cycled through hitting coaches about every 12 months, and it seems same old, same old.
Yeah, I mean, I think there's a few things. The way this team is constructed, just from a roster standpoint, there aren't a lot of guys who are getting on base. You know, we look at and getting into scoring position, because there's a lot that's been made. I just wrote about this, I think it was Tuesday. A lot has been made of the Cubs' performance and hitting with runners in scoring position. But if you break it down and you look statistically at batting average, at the other kind of all around, whether, you know, a stat like WOBA or WRC+, they are actually better in those statistics than they were in 2016. And 2016 was the best they've been in the Theo Epstein era. Now, we can go a lot of different ways with that, but the main problem is that they have been putting fewer runners. They have fewer at-bats per game with runners in scoring position, fewer plate appearances than they have at any point since 2015. And that's just not going to get it done. I mean, they're a full, I think it's 1.8 plate appearances per game fewer with runners in scoring position than they were in their World Championship season. So you're thinking, okay, well, that's 2 plate appearances a game. Now all of a sudden you put that over 90 games, that's 180 plate appearances. How many more runs could you score, even if all you do is continue to bat 250? You know, you're scoring a bunch more runs. That's a bunch more wins. So, to me, it comes down to Kyle Schwarber in the leadoff spot is just not getting it done. He's got a .307 on-base percentage as a leadoff hitter. And if you look at it, what was the problem early on? He starts out in leadoff, and he's sitting on pitches, and he's striking out looking at an inordinate rate. So he changes something. He gets more aggressive. Well, that's great. He's getting more hits. He's not striking out as often, but he's not reaching base as much. He needs to be moved down in the order. My solution would be go with a platoon of Jason Hayward and Wilson Contreras based on the handedness of the pitcher, because those guys both reach base at a 400-plus clip against opposite-handed pitchers. Now you've raised your OBP at the top of the lineup by over 100 points, and that gives runners to the guys behind them to be able to drive. Many put Schwarber in more of a run-scoring, kind of a run-driving in, fifth, sixth spot in the order. I think that fixes a lot of things.
I know why I love Kyle Schwarber, and it's because he went to Indiana University, and he took Indiana University on his back to the College World Series. I never thought I'd see that in my lifetime, so I know where my love comes from. Joe Maddon, Theo Epstein, Jed Hoyer, why do they love Kyle Schwarber?
I think it's because, and I'm with you there as well, right? From the moment that I heard even an inkling of rumor that the Cubs might be drafting him fourth, I was really psyched about it. And just because the idea of a Hoosier, other than Mickey Morandini, playing for the Cubs, right? And I didn't even really know at the time that the Dandy Little Glove Man was a Hoosier. That was before my time. But still, he's Mickey Morandini, and he was kind of one of the dirtbags from the Phillies, and that was cool. But anyway, a lot of it is Schwarber is a guy who everybody who knows him loves him. He came in and really just made fans out of the front office. They loved his mentality and his overall makeup. And when you combine that with a lefty bat who's got a ton of pop, you know, those things, I think, cause people to maybe be a little bit more enamored of him than what his results have shown. And he gives us flashes. Like, you see it sometimes where he'll work a 13-pitch at-bat and then blast a home run. And you're like, this guy can be the best hitter on the team. And then you see him, you know, take two fastballs and then just wave at a curveball that he's got no shot at in three pitches. And you're like, well, this guy's terrible. Why is he here? So he's a microcosm of this offensive inconsistency. And again, that's not a guy you really want setting the table. That's fine if you can hide him. I thought he hit great in the sixth spot last year. But I think this front office, if there is an Achilles heel, it is that they fall in love with these guys that they've drafted or traded for, or, you know, they're, I don't want to say they're unwilling to admit a mistake, but I think they want so badly for these guys to succeed that they've had there, and they want to see that through, even in the case of someone like Addison Russell, to a detriment to where now they've reached a point where you can't sell them because the value has gotten too low. And so it's kind of they're kind of in a ride or die situation. And unfortunately it appears that they might be, you can hear the kind of the death rattle, if you will, in breathing with some of this. And ideally these guys do come back and get better, but Schwarber's one of them who I think they maybe like a little too much.
That's what happens when you try to turn your business into a family, because you can't fire family. And you can't do that. You have to keep your distance from your employees and treat them as employees. And it seems like Theo and Jed, just as you said, don't do that. I think, follow me here and tell me whether I'm out of my mind, because I might be a little bit out of my depth. But it looks to me like guys like Schwarber, they are trying so hard to be mediocre at what they had been bad at. They're trying to lift their floor, that they're not maintaining their ceiling. They're no longer being great at what they're great at, because all the focus is lifting the bottom to be mediocre.
No, I think that makes a lot of sense. And that's sort of the risk you run. And with a lot of these guys, and rightfully so, they were promoted really quickly. We saw that with Chris Bryant, Bryant is so much, I mean, it's not even a comparison to say, you know, Bryant Schwarber, but look, both of them moved really quickly. Ian Happ moved really quickly through the system initially. And a lot of that was because they were able to leverage some of those superior talents that they have. But then what you see and what Bryant has been able to do that none of these other guys have to that extent is he's been able to adjust as pitchers have adjusted back to him. And you can look at his numbers, and it's really interesting. And we're going to see a bump from him in the second half as he figures out the high fastball. But Schwarber hasn't done it. Ian Happ definitely hasn't done it. Maybe he's come around a little bit at AAA. But, yeah, as they've done this, they've pushed these guys through so quickly that I think the problem is, okay, if they – and the Cubs love that. They love to see how guys adjust to struggles. The only problem is some people don't ever come back from that or can't come back from that. And that's – again, that's the ceiling part. I think they saw that the ceiling was really high, and I kind of made this joke before. It's like that's really cool, and they've got this high ceiling, but if you only give them a 5-foot step ladder – it doesn't matter how high the ceiling is. They're only going to climb so high, and now they're reaching, and you get into trouble with that. And it looks like they've done that, and then you overbalance and you end up on your ass.
Talking to Evan Altman, of course, from CubsInsider.com. And so, do you take Theo at his word that if this thing doesn't turn around, if they don't pivot, he's going to make moves? Because we haven't seen him do that. We haven't seen him become a seller. We haven't seen him make dynamic changes. He's tinkered a little bit, but he's never gone like, all right, this is ridiculous, and we're going to make moves.
No, I mean, maybe there have been, but how many parents actually turn the car around when they threaten to, when the kids are acting up in the back seat, right? You're
right,
in Disney World.
Right.
You know, in Southern Georgia. Well, there you go. He's like the one ever. But if you're driving from Indianapolis to Disney World and you're already in Georgia, you ain't turning the car around. You know, like, the kids are all back there like, yeah, sure, Dad. Okay, it's shorter to get to where we're going. And I said, you know, when Theo Epstein says in October that players are going to be held accountable and it's production over talent, and then the only move they make is to sign Daniel Descalso, who is, again, somehow still on the roster, and then to demote Ian Happ, and there really hasn't been anything else. And now to come out and say it again, like, okay, well, what does that mean? And I don't think it can possibly mean any of the main core players, but there is something to be said for, you know, at some point they're going to have to make moves that they haven't before, even if that means parting with guys who they signed to more than one-year deals, whether that's Brad Brock or Daniel Descalso, or maybe it's Brandon Kinsler, and eating some of that money and just saying, you know what, hey, we gave you this contract, but – dude, if you're hitting 100 over your last 100 plate appearances, you don't have a roster spot on a contender. This is guys like that were members of the Cubs teams in 2012 and 2013 when they didn't want to win, you know, and you could afford to keep that guy on the roster because you actually wanted it because you didn't want to win games. But now you can't afford that. And that's the part they need to change. And I'm still baffled by the fact that they haven't been more aggressive already, but again, it is what it is, I suppose.
What do we think about Garcia? I mean, I know that he's not going to, over the course of his career, he's not going to have an OPS of 1.552. That's a ludicrous number, but he's showed flashes, and at least he's having some fun out there. Is he a guy we're going to see more often at second base and maybe Addison Russell a little bit less?
I hope so. I really hope so. And this is a guy who I've been talking about for probably a solid month, if not at least a few weeks, of just, hey, ton of power from both sides. At the very least, here's an injection of energy into a team that at times has just looked like it's sleepwalking. The pitchers don't have a book on this guy because he hasn't even been stateside in 5 years. And he's just blazing through two levels of the minors because guess what? He's going to swing and miss a lot, but boy, he's going to run into a fastball. And when he does, he can punish it. We've seen he's already hit two home runs. He's got a triple, you know, and he is going. Here's a guy who appreciates the opportunity. 26 years old, finally getting into the major leagues, been in Italy for 5 years. So the one thing you know you're going to get is effort, 110%, just going all the way out. And so even if that only lasts for like 2 weeks or a month or whatever, at least it's a boost of energy, and it's a guy who's coming in and busting his butt. And I think people take something away from that. So, hey, does this continue? I don't know. I would imagine that once pitchers get the book on him, we start seeing a lot more of that swing and miss again. But for the time being, at least, he's a serviceable player out there. And I think he's got a role for as long as he's hot.
And you're right. They need energy. Anything that brings it, I'm all about. What about Hamels? What's his situation injury-wise?
You know, he has said, and he had an injury like this, although it was to the right side a couple years ago, and that caused him to miss a solid month. he's indicated that it doesn't feel as bad, although it's on his left side, and being left-handed, you know, that's gonna affect things a bit. But I do also think that the team is being overly cautious with this, and so, you know, he's probably going to be out for a couple weeks more, just because they want to make sure this thing heals up all the way, and given how well he's pitched, they can't afford. And I mean, as you know too, you know, here's a guy who's what, 35, 36 years old. You don't really heal up from things quite as easily when you're 36 right. as what you do when you're 26. So they can't afford to have him go out and re-injure it and then have this thing kind of linger. So, you know, a couple more weeks, and I think he gets back out there, and they've got some guys that can bridge the gap in the meantime. But you're probably looking at August, and then he'll be right back in, if not a little bit before.
Should we be paying attention to what Nico Horner does in the minors and look for him in September?
I think so, absolutely. You know, I said that at the beginning of the season, that I could see him being fast-tracked to the point of being a September call-up. If he, you know, I said he's probably going to start in Double A, which ended up happening, and, you know, skipped Myrtle Beach entirely and really started hitting well at Double A. And what's really impressive is here's a guy who had a fractured wrist, which, as you know, for a baseball player, can sometimes be a bit of a death knell, or at least for that season. We saw it with Derek Lee.
Right.
Those things take a long time sometimes, but he came right back, home run in his second game back, doesn't appear to be missing a beat. And the real key to it is that though he played shortstop coming up for the most part, has played a lot of second base and just started Wednesday night in center for Tennessee. And so you're talking about a guy being shifted out to those positions like that. You look at the Cubs and think, well, gosh, Albert Almora is out there in center. He has not been hitting well at all. There's a spot that could be there. I really think if Horner's able to keep this up, he could see a trip to Iowa and then maybe kind of take that trip through Chicago, if for no other reason than to acclimate him to the big leagues, let him get that chance with the expanded rosters in September, and then probably start back out at AAA Iowa again next year. But it's definitely not beyond question that he is up in Chicago at some point.
Hey, tell me about your experience co-hosting, filling in on The Score up in Chicago. How'd it go?
It was a pretty cool deal. They're combining. So, you know, Intercom owns multiple radio stations there. And in the past, they've occupied, I think, four floors in the Prudential Tower. And they're renovating and consolidating down to two floors. So the whole thing is torn up. And so our show is actually hosted in the culinary kitchen. That they are the culinary studio. Yeah. So we were literally in a kitchen that they used to like film little segments from time to time. But you know, a really cool deal. It's actually the second time I've been here. The first time I've actually been asked to come up and co-host. The other time was kind of a spur of the moment, but it flew by, and I was kind of surprised at how quickly 4 hours goes by. And it was kind of nice to be able to talk on a little bit more than just the Cubs and kind of get into a few things. But, you know, cool deal all around, and got to bring my daughter up with me and just spend some time in the city. And we went to the Cubs-White Sox game on Saturday, and we were fairly close to all the fighting that was going on.
So, were you?
You know, oh, yeah.
Great.
It was awesome. And I went, I you know, there were fights all night, and then late I had to go hit the restroom. And as I'm coming out, there's a woman in Cubs gear. Very, very boisterous woman who's screaming and carrying on, being dragged out by multiple security guards. And my daughter gave me the lowdown. And that was a big fight between like five or six women, just a royal rumble that had been going on. And so yeah, it's great fun at the old ballpark, you know?
You know what? During those brawls, and there's some inequity here, women are treated with kid gloves by the ushers, by the Andy Frames. There's a tolerance for their ill behavior that just doesn't exist with guys. If they had been guys, they would have been tased, they would have been put down, they would have been dragged out of Comiskey Park or whatever the hell they call that place by their ankles. But these women, they were kind of nice with.
Yeah, it was a little bit odd. And you know, the troublesome part, I think, of the whole thing was like, and I don't know what else you're going to do. You can't kick out entire sections, but there had been stuff going on for several innings and like three different things
really?
Kind of breaking out. Beer being thrown at people as they were leaving. It was a weird kind of, and it is part of it's like you get a game like that, it turns into amateur hour because, you know, people think it's more of a rivalry than what it is. And of course they have tailgate lots there too. And so, you know, the ballpark is relatively empty until first pitch because everybody's out there tailgating. So they're getting sauced up pretty good before they come in. You know, which you can do at Wrigley, but it's a little bit different when you're paying like $10 a beer than when you can bring in a case at a time of your own and drink in your RV out there.
So, Southside, man.
Yeah, and it's different. That's how it works. But it was overall, you know, we were sitting in the Goose Island section they have there. I cannot recommend highly enough. It is
really
fantastic. Well, they let Goose Island kind of design it like they want. It's got that was like TimberTech. Like it's like a decking. It's like a big giant outdoor patio. I mean, tiered level still, but you have like a little setup, like a little shelf in front of you, basically, and kind of patio chairs. You're up there, so tons of room behind you. You can get up, individual chairs, move around as you see fit. Servers come out, take your orders. You have access to their entire list of beer from the craft cave down below. So like 80 different beers that you can choose from. And again, you don't even have to get up to go. You just run a tab just like you would at a bar. It's great. And so you don't have to like leave or miss any of the action if you don't want to.
You've piqued my interest. If I didn't loathe the White Sox and all things outside of Chicago, I'd be on my way already.
Well, there you go. See, that's so if it wasn't such a horrible place to attend, it would be a great place to attend, right? But we actually, again, we had a lot, because we stayed downtown. We were able to jump on the Red Line right there at the lake stop and just ride it a few stops south of 35th, jump right back on and get up there. So it was really easy in and out, all things considered, other than the fight. And as luck would have it, there was a gentleman wearing a White Sox jersey with the name Altman on the back. And so I was able to go introduce myself to someone who may or may not have been related in a distant manner, and that was fun too.
Isn't that nice? Thank you for joining me, as always, Evan. I appreciate it.
Not a problem at all. Thanks for having me on again.
Evan always makes me feel good about the Chicago Cubs, and I thank him for it because I'm one of those guys. It doesn't take much. It doesn't take much for me to watch game after game after game and see joyless performances and think that that's all we're ever going to see again. I want to be 8 years old. You know what? Just like when I was 8 years old, I want to be like that. I want to watch the Cubs, and when they go through one of these little downturns where they're kind of, you know, it's like they're playing underwater, I want to say, you know what? Tomorrow's another day. Let's go. Let's play two. I want to be like Ernie Banks. I want to see I want to see the good stuff. I want to see reason for hope. I want to be an optimist. I don't want to be a cynic. When it comes to the Chicago Cubs, I don't want to be one of those guys who, because since 2015, there's really been nothing but success, including that World Series run in 2016. I don't want to be one of those guys who get, you know, well, they're only four games over 500 and they're in first place, but let's face it, they're not playing real good baseball. I don't want to be one of those guys. I want to be hopeful. I want to be optimistic. Let's go. Come on. Let's be happy. Let's turn it around for us. All right. Whether Chris Bryant and Kyle Schwarber and Anthony Rizzo and those guys, whether they're smiling and beaming and happy like they were in 2015, or they're kind of like, well, it's another season of this with these guys. You know what? That's their business. Our business is enjoying being Cubs fans or fans of whatever team you're a fan of. Let's be happy about things. Let's not take for granted an amount of success just because the payroll is where it is or the expectations are where they are. Let's be optimists. Let's be reasonable people. I know sometimes those are at odds, but I want to be happy. I want to watch a Cubs like I did back in 1978 or 79. We're at the Kentucky State Fair at whatever that exposition hall is, and I see a TV, and it's the Cubs and the Reds, and the Cubs are dead. Like two outs, bottom of the ninth, and the Cubs, they weren't very good in 1978, and they've got guys who aren't, got guys like Steve Dillard and Dave Rader coming up. And you know what Dave Rader does? Dave Rader, with the bases loaded, hits a bases clearing double off the vines in right field, and the Cubs score enough to win. And I'm jumping up and down at the Kentucky State Fair like they just won the World Series. I want to be a Cubs fan like that again. And Evan helps me do it every day at CubsInsider.com. He's terrific at following the nuts and bolts of the Cubs, but conveying all those nuts and bolts with wonderful enthusiasm. I cannot recommend it highly enough. Anyway, that's sports, nothing but sports. Tomorrow, Breakfast with Kent at 8 o'clock on Facebook Live, and then Periscope Live at 8:15. And then on Sports, nothing but sports tomorrow, it'll post by 3 o'clock. Harry's going to have questions. It's going to be questions and answers with Harry, which is kind of a Friday tradition from time to time, at least. We'll have that for you again by 3 o'clock. All of this stuff brought to you by the great people at Today's Dentistry. Give them a call. Become their next new patient. 317-849-2933. Join me tomorrow morning. Join me tomorrow afternoon. And thanks for joining me this afternoon.